Marius. Okay, lecture two on quantum information for quantum gravity. The plan, four parts. The first on correlations and mutual information. The second on Gaussian states and how to compute entanglement in Gaussian states. Then area law as promised, and something more sophisticated about thinking about the area law and other aspects of entanglement entropy in terms of subalgebras of observables. As relevance, I'm going to indicate some examples about foundations of statistical mechanics and this way of thinking about correlations. All these aspects about entanglement in Gaussian states are relevant for, quantum field theory. You saw in Ivan Aguglio's lectures on quantum field theory in cross space times the use of these Gaussian states, and we're going to use the same methods for computing entanglement. Area law, as you know, for the nature of black hole entropy and also for the structure of space time geometry in quantum gravity. And the example that I'm going to give uses tools that are not for a given lattice, but for a generic graph that you might find interesting. As usual, resources, references on the website, and there are four notebooks on the website. I'm going to mainly use the fourth one. So if you have time to look at it, you can find all the construction from getting the plots. I'm going to reserve time for questions. Please ask questions in the chat or at any time. Okay, good. So let's start. Mutual information. I need to introduce a few structures before telling you about mutual information and why it's important. The first structure, the first object is the notion of relative entropy. So let's first define it. The definition is, the relative entropy of a density matrix rho with respect to density matrix sigma is S rho given sigma equal trace rho log rho minus rho log sigma. This is the definition. Before giving you an interpretation of this quantity, let me give you an exercise. Prove that it's non-negative. And equality if and only if rho equals sigma. The proof takes two steps. One is Jensen inequality that we saw last time. The second is there's a classical version of this statement for the relative entropy. It's called the Gibbs inequality. So if you know the Gibbs inequality together with Jensen inequality, you should be able to prove it. Now, why this is useful and important? So let me give you an interpretation for it. So relative entropy interpretation. So this quantity, S rho given sigma, measures the distinguishability of rho from sigma. And to be more concrete, here is a result that is important and we're going to use. I'll state it in the form of a theorem. So let's take an observable O and compute the expectation value of this observable O on the state of the mixed state rho and compare it to the expectation value of the same observable on a different state sigma. Okay, and I'm interested in how far they are, or if I can use these observables to distinguish the two. theta square, so that can think of it as a distance. Clearly, this quantity depends on like the norm of O. So I'm going to divide by norm of the observable O so that it's independent from that. And the theorem is that this quantity is smaller than the relative entropy rho given sigma for all observable O. Okay. And as this one is important, it's good to sketch the proof. I'm going to use it later. So it's good to see this. So I need a few things. First of all, I need a definition of or a reminder of what are these norms that appear. The first is the norm of the operator O, which I'm assuming that is bounded. So this is look at O squared, even if it's not Hermitian, it's okay, on a state. So the sup over all states, this gives you the norm of O. And I'm gonna need also a second quantity that is this one norm that is defined as trace of operator dagger operator square root. Now with these two definitions, you can just use the following inequalities. The first is that the relative entropy is bounds from above this distance, the one distance squared. This is called Pinsker inequality. And the second is the inequality that x norm one is larger than trace of x O normalized for all O. When you put the two together, you see that it's immediate to prove this relation, okay? Now, why this is important? So let's consider a physical system now. I'm interested in correlations. So a good way of thinking about it is I have a system in a pure state and I measure part of the system, the part A and the part B, without probing all of the system. So let's introduce a tripartition. And it's here where I introduce this notion of mutual information. The picture is I have A, I have B, they have all the rest, say C, and the three together form an isolated quantum system. So my Hilbert space is by construction a tensor product of the Hilbert spaces of the three subsystems. I take a pure state, psi in H, and I'm gonna need the restriction to the subsystems. In particular, to A, to B, and to AB together. Let me write them down. Rho A is trace over the rest, that is BC of psi psi. Rho B trace over AC of psi psi. And then also rho AB is the trace over C of psi psi. Okay, so now the question that I want to ask. Is the following. Suppose that you have access only to the subsystem AB. You make measurements only in AB. How distinguishable is the state rho AB from the state where you cannot look at correlations between A and B? In words, how distinguishable is, so I said rho AB from rho A times rho B. And the tool that we built is exactly for doing this, the relative entropy. Use relative entropy. So let's write it explicitly. The relative entropy of rho AB given rho A times rho B. I write it, my first definition, rho AB log rho AB minus rho AB log rho A cross rho B times rho B. I expand it. Yeah, this is immediate to prove. You just write it in terms of projector. You can see that this decomposes as the sum of two terms. And finally, you recognize the definitions of the entanglement entropy that we discussed at length last time. So this is SA plus SB minus SAB. So now I'm ready to give you the definition of mutual information. Mutual information. Definition. So the mutual information of AB and C for a pure state psi is the entanglement entropy of psi restricted to A plus restricted to B minus restricted to AB. You could ask if this quantity is positive, and if you already solved the exercise that I gave here, because the relative entropy is positive, you know that this mutual information is bounded from below. And it's zero if you cannot tell apart rho AB from rho A tensor rho B, which means that you have to coincide. Okay, so what do we do with this?
Eugenio, yes. Can I interrupt you for a second to ask if we're using a Menti today for the questions?
Yes, if anybody wants to ask questions on Menti, you can go ahead. The link is the same as last time, so you can
post it. Okay, I will send the information in the chat. Thank you.
Sorry. And I can bring it up when there are questions. I see them in a second screen. So when you ask a question, I should see it coming up. Okay, Feel free to ask as many questions as you want. Like of the trivial kind, or the more advanced kind, or the most speculative kind, just don't hesitate. Okay, I go ahead. So what do we do with this? So mutual information interpretation. By the definition that I gave before, we know that this quantity tells us about the distinguishability of these two objects. But physically, you can think of it as I described in this previous theorem here. As I make measurements and I look at expectation values. So let me build it here. So what it does is that it provides an upper bound on what? Now it depends on A and B. Provides an upper bound for correlations between A and B. And let me write it concretely as one way of thinking about it. And I'm gonna state it again in the form of a theorem. We're gonna use later. So take two observables, one that probes only A and one that probes only B. And write the correlation function for these two. Okay, in quantum field theory, for instance, this could be the two-point correlation function where A is a point, B is another point, or A and B could be two regions, and this is any observable in region A and any observable in region B. And the statement I want to make is that the mutual information provides a bound. Now, what a bound is independent of A and B, and clearly I can just make this one larger if I just multiply this one by some constant. That's not what I'm interested in. So let me divide by the norms of OA and OB to get rid of that. And clearly I'm assuming that they are bounded. I take a square so that I don't have to worry about the sign of this difference. And with a 1/2, I can prove that this is smaller than the mutual information IAB or the pure state sign. And this is an extremely useful result. So let's box it. What's the proof? Well, you just use theorem one with rho equal rho AB and sigma equal rho A tensor rho B. And the result holds for all observables OA and OB. Let's also restate the picture. The picture is take your, let's say, extended system that is isolated and in a pure state, and the state of this isolated quantum system is psi. Now I can make measurements on a subsystem A, measurements on a subsystem B. In quantum field theory, in quantum gravity, they might be spatially separated. And look at correlation functions of any observable we support in this region or in this region, or if this was a lattice support on this, on the sub-Hilbert space associated to these degrees of freedom. And now clearly you want to compute correlations. Those, each one is gonna depend on the specific observables that you look at. If you want to make a statement that is for all possible observables in a region or in the other, the mutual information helps you make those kind of statements. So put it in writing, you could think of, let's say many spins, you measure only sigma z of spins in A and sigma z of spins in B or in QFT. Measure phi of x, me x in A or B, connect correlation function. Okay, so this is extremely general. Now I want to show you an application that uses the notions that we discussed in the first lecture. So it's a model system. I'm gonna take a spin system and a state, I'm gonna extract a state randomly from the Hilbert space and look at properties of this mutual information. Then a second example, I'm gonna choose a special state, for instance, two entangled spins in a single state together with many other spins. and look at the time evolution with some random Hamiltonian and see what we learn from that. So first part is mutual information. For a random state.
Eugenio, yes. We have a request maybe before you continue.
From yes.
If you could show us theorem 2 again.
Absolutely. Yeah, ask if you want me to comment on it. If you want to help me read it. So if yeah, there's a correlation function.
If you want to unmute and ask.
Yeah, so I see, please do comment, I can comment. So here there's a correlation function. I'm just dividing by the normalization of the operator so that it doesn't depend on its form. And I'm taking the square so that this is a measure of how big this correlation function is. And as you see, depends on the observables, but as long as these observables probe only A and B, this correlation function, the theorem states, is always below this mutual information. So for instance, if I was to prove that this mutual information is zero, then I would know that you can look at correlation functions of any observables in A and B, and they will always be zero. And so you don't have to do a hard computation of each one of them for any couple of observables.
Right, thanks. I just needed to look at the statement. Once I looked at the statement, it's clear what it means. Thanks, Eugene.
You're welcome. Hi Deepak. I'm gonna give an example that is, I think, as concrete as it can get. So a random state, I'm gonna take a random state of N equal NA plus NB plus NC spins. And I'm going to assume spins, I mean spin 1/2, and I'm going to assume that NC is much larger than NA plus NB. Now, if it's a random state, I can use page result that we discussed yesterday. So I can compute in particular the average mutual information. So this average mutual information, A, B, and C, average over all states, just using the definition, it's average SA plus average SB minus average SAB. Then I use page result that tells me that the first is NA log 2 minus something of order 2 to the minus NC. The second is NB log 2 minus something of order 2 to the minus NC. Then the third that is minus, important, NA plus NB log 2 plus order 2 to the minus NC, which clearly shows that in a random state, this mutual information is exponentially small. Well, I said a bit more than it actually shows. It shows that the average over all states is exponentially small. So you could ask how many states there are for which this is large. So make a statement of typicality. I can also look at the dispersion around the average. Delta I, A, B, C. We computed dispersion, discussed dispersions last time for the entropy. Just use that result. Get then the dispersion for the mutual information is again 2 to the minus NC. And so this is really a statement of typicality. In particular, if now I use theorem 2 about correlations, this implies that there are exponentially small correlations in a random state. Okay, so let's put in some more details. So example, if you had the time to check notebook 4, in here I work out the case of a spin system with in A there's just one spin, in B there's just one spin, and then the total number of spins is just 10. And just to draw it, A, B, C. Let me choose an initial state. And let's assume that it's pure, not just pure, but maximally entangled in AB. So let me take, for instance, this one, the singlet in AB we saw yesterday times something in C. And let's look at the evolution with a random Hamiltonian. Just mean psi t is e to the minus I ht psi naught, where this Hamiltonian is a random matrix extracted from some ensemble, Gaussian Hermitian ensemble. So I'm interested in the evolution. Evolution of what? Evolution of the entanglement entropy. End of the mutual information. And if you look at the notebook, and maybe you run it for longer time than what you see in there, takes a bit, yeah, but you would see this. So what is this plot? So you see, well, first, what are the axes? So you have here entropy and here time. So entropy, let's see what they are. So this is the red one is SA, the blue one is SB. At the initial time t equals zero, I prepared it in a single state. So at the initial time, I should see a log two. 0.69 looks good, log two. But then as a function of time, as it's coupled to the rest of the system, the entropy is going to start changing. And not surprisingly, it's below the maximum log two, but it doesn't drop. And it goes to something that we studied last time. This average is the page average. And this dispersion around the average is the one that I showed you that one can compute. And so you see that a two sigma stays in approximately 95% of the time. So let me try to put this. So this is S page. Oh, if you want. This is S page plus or minus two delta S page. That's the bound. Okay. We can also look again at the same plot, but for the rest of the spins for C. So that's a separate plot. And I think I have it's this one. Okay, so what happens to C? What happens to C? So this is again plot of entropy versus time. And what I'm plotting here is SC, if you want, or analogously, you could say SAB, which is T which is equal to SC of T. And you see what's happening? It's zero at the beginning because I took them unentangled, EB with C. And then it grows to 2 log 2, or approximately, which is the maximum. And how does it go there? Should I make more space? No, I can do it as an inset. So let me zoom in this region here. Does it go to a constant? Well, at this point, you've seen this enough times that you should expect that it doesn't go to a constant. It actually fluctuates around the page average. So that's zoom in. Okay. Now, we are interested in correlations. For instance, suppose that you measure the spin in here and the spin in here, and also spin correlations AB. And you can ask, how do these spin correlations go? So for that, you're going to need the mutual information as a bound. And you have the plot for that. Let me show you. So the mutual information starts large. So this is time, and here there's IAB in C of ZT. It starts large. They are maximally entangled A and B, so this is 2 log 2. And it drops down. It drops down to zero. Well, I can look at exactly where it drops. It doesn't drop down to zero, but it drops down exactly where we would expect. It is, if I zoom in, yes, is there a question?
Probably somebody unmuted by mistake. I do have a suggestion though, Eugenie, there is a couple of comments in the chat, and I have the same, I think the feeling is, can we have some intuitive understanding of relative entropy and mutual information? I think people are trying to see how to imagine this quantity exactly.
Yeah, so I would argue that if you want an interpretation, one can always say, well, it's a measure of this distance between two reduced states. But if you want an interpretation, really think about these statements, no? You see, this is a quantity that depends only on the state and on subsystems. And now if you want to probe its behavior, you can explore what you can measure in subsystems. And the interpretation is you can explore subsystems by making measurements of them as far as you want, and at most you're gonna saturate this inequality. And I will get to the point of, and that's what I'm gonna do in part four, reversing the logic and always thinking of entropy and of entanglement entropy as, instead of taking just two observables, take a full algebra of observables and use that to define the restriction of the entropy to a subsystem. Instead of thinking of the subsystem as something that is either already given to you or localized in space, you could just say the subsystem is defined by what these algebra of observables can probe, okay? I see also there's another question in the comments that is, can SA plus MB minus SAB become negative? So let's look first at the plot. So here you see it's going close to zero, but it's staying above zero. So the plot shows that it doesn't get to zero, but you can also go back to the theorem where you see that this quantity is defined as a relative entropy, and the exercise one was proved that relative entropy is always positive. There's also another question, when do you get equality in theorem two? Yeah, this is less trivial. I don't have a statement for given a state, you can always find observables that saturate this equality. Because I set it up in a way as an inequality that is actually useful. But if you go back to a similar statement we saw in lecture one for the entanglement entropy, so if you want, not this difference, but each one of them, if you recall, I made a statement of this entanglement entropy provides a bound on the measurement entropy of all observables in A. And this one you can show that you can saturate, okay? So I'm saying the one that I gave you last time for the entanglement entropy actually provides an interpretation in the sense that you can always saturate it. This one, I'm not sure. I think you need additional requirements on the state. In general, it doesn't, you cannot find a way of saturating. Okay? Are there more comments or questions?
Yes, I have one, Eugenia. Yeah. So just to help the discussion, I see that this is a part, because of this inequality, it's a powerful tool to both ways, to both make statements about observables without calculating them. Mm-hmm. And then you're saying you're more interested though on the other sense, putting a lower bound in mutual information. Now, why is this quantity, mutual information, interesting on its own right? So let's say you go through all this story and then you can make a statement about mutual information. What is it about this specific notion of information that is especially meaningful?
Yeah, I would really, let me be precise. There are other ways of thinking about this quantity in terms of distinguishability. You can make statements about distinguishability by really reading directly the definition that is this one. No, this is the definition. So you could go backwards and say, this is the definition. And of this relative entropy, we already gave a definition of how you can distinguish rho AB from rho A tensor rho B. But then in practice, when you use it is, you won't make statements about correlations in some quantum state. And every time you say correlations in a state, you have to say correlations of what observables. And these correlations take work to compute. And once you've found that in some observable correlations, for instance, go to zero, you still haven't proved that any observable in the subsystem as correlation that goes to zero. You would have to check each one of them. So this is a powerful tool in the sense that it really gives you a way of speaking about correlations between subsystems and not correlations between a specific measurement in the subsystem. Okay?
Yeah, thanks.
Good. So let's close this.
Sorry, excuse me.
Yes, go ahead.
Can I ask you one more question?
Go ahead.
So above those two graphs, there was a calculation where you show that the relative entropy is of order of 2 to the minus nc.
Yes.
I'm not sure if I'm getting this right. So this calculation sort of does show that the mutual information is negative.
Why?
Because
you're subtracting these ones?
Yeah, that's right.
Oh, but no, you have to think of them as equivalence classes in the sense of, I'm not telling you what is the coefficient in front of them. If you were to go to that order, and track the coefficients will be positive. When I say order 2 to the minus nc, I'm not telling you if it's 3 times 2 to the minus nc, if it's 1/2.
Oh, I see.
Okay. Yeah. So if you go to the statement of the page result in lecture 1, you find this order, this exponentially suppressed orders computed explicitly. You plug them in and you can get exactly this one, and you can say, well, yeah, it's one specific 2 to the minus nc plus corrections of order 2 to the minus 2 nc. Okay?
Okay. Okay.
Good. So to summarize, correlations of A with B become in time exponentially small. And this is really a statement of decoherence due to coupling C. And it's clear the long time behavior. But you could ask, how quick is it? What's the time scale of this decoherence? And Rishabh Kumar has been working on it as a series of very nice results about this short time scale. And I hope you will be able to see the paper soon. This is worked out in detail. Okay, so that concludes part one, where told you mostly about mutual information. Now let's go to part two, that is about Gaussian states. I think there were quite a few questions, so I'm just going to start with this part two. It's not long, and I'm going to take more questions as we go ahead. So, two. So this is entanglement in Gaussian states. Start with this, is disconnected from what we have seen before. As I told you, I've selected a few topics that I think are helpful in researching quantum gravity. And when you look at Gaussian states for bosonic systems, you see that there's immediately a difficulty that you have to address. It is the Hilbert space of an harmonic oscillator is infinite dimensional. And all of the statements of typicality that I made before, they were all for finite dimension. So you need to add something. Now, that doesn't mean that you cannot speak about typical states. You can speak about typical states of finite energy. That's another topic of relevance. Here, instead of the class of typical states, I'm going to look at the class of Gaussian states. These are important. These arise as a ground state of quadratic Hamiltonians. If you start with a Gaussian state and then the Hamiltonian is time dependent, you just send Gaussian states into Gaussian states via squeezing. A lot of quantum field theory in core space times is really a free field theory in core space times. It's mostly about Gaussian states or vacua, as you saw in Ivan Aguglio's lectures. And there's a wealth of phenomena that arise just from Gaussian states. If you want the temperature anisotropy in the CMB can be traced back to correlations in a primordial Gaussian state for curvature perturbations. If you're interested in all of the theory behind with Luca Sacra, we have recently put out this long paper where there's all the theory needed for looking at these quantities. That's not what I can do in 30 or 40 minutes, but I can give you some motivation for looking at that by taking the simplest possible system. That is just two oscillators. And then we will go ahead from there. So consider two oscillators. and let's prepare them in a Gaussian state. The Hilbert space of the system, if they are isolated, is just the Hilbert space of one, L2 of R, tensor the Hilbert space of the other, L2 of R. I'm going to think of this one as A, this one as B, and in these are my oscillators. Now, I'm going to consider a Gaussian state that in position representation I can write as xA, xB, normalization, and generally, it's restricted case where the expectation values are at zero. So x a squared minus coefficient xB squared minus a coupling xA, xB. And you can ask how to prepare it. Well, I don't know, you could put a spring between the two and look at the ground state, or do something more complicated. But once you prepare it, you can look at measurements of one or of the other, or correlations between the two. And a lot of the tools that we have built are exactly for this. So so you want to be able to compute the entanglement entropy. So how do we compute the entanglement entropy? How to compute? It's really a question of the task of computing that I want to address. What tools do you have? Well, you first start by writing the density matrix. This is easy. Row A as a matrix X A XA prime is just trace over B. Now the trace is an integral. Psi XA XB Psi star XA prime XB. All good up to now. And now that you have the density matrix, you're going to compute the entropy. So SA of psi, which by definition is trace of A of rho A log rho A. But you see that this log, this is a matrix log, clearly. So how do you do the matrix log of this matrix? It's infinite dimensional continuous matrix. So there are a few strategies that you could follow. One is, just diagonalize rho A, and then it's easy. So find eigenvalues. Let's call them lambda k of this rho A of x prime seen as the kernel of some operator. And then you're done, because this becomes sum of a k, lambda k, log lambda k. Still, you have to do this step of finding the eigenvalues, which might be non-trivial, especially because this is a model system, but then I want a tool that I can use for any number of oscillators, for instance, a lattice of oscillators, or even a quantum field theory. Second possible strategy is the so-called replica trick. But in this case, it just means you write SA. You first use this trick of writing it as the limit R to one of the derivative respect to R of something that you can compute. You see this quantity, this you can compute it. These are just R integrals of the same kind as the appear here. You just do rho A, rho A, you integrate over the intermediate value. The thing is that you have to do that integral R times, and then you have to continue to R in the real line. So you first do R replicas, and then you send this replica to being continuum, and then you take the derivative and set it to one. This is often useful, used for instance, for computing some quantities in quantum field theory. And it takes some work. And I'm gonna tell you a third one. It is the one that I want to discuss. And it's a one, it's one that has an immediate physical interpretation in the sense that the way you compute the quantity reflects the way you would measure it if you were to do an experiment. So entropy from correlations. In what sense? In the sense that I explain in a moment. Now exercise. Compute, let's say for this super simple system, using each one of these strategies. You do first A, then B, then C, and C I haven't explained yet. Well, in fact, this one you can guess, this one you can see if you just Google replica trick, but C is the one that I'm gonna explain, okay? And as an exercise, do all three and compare which one you find most useful or most straightforward. So I explain C, okay? Time is good. So to explain C, I have to tell you about correlations. Correlations and some mathematics of color structures. It's nothing fancy, you're gonna see. So take a bosonic system. Let's say n bosonic degrees of freedom. Concretely, you could think of it as QNPN, N1, N, and canonical commutation relations. Okay. Now, for what I'm going to explain, it's useful to introduce like a phase space variable. So I'm just going to define it. I'm going to call it psi A. It just means Q1, P1. N, and if you write, and this A as an index goes from 1 to 2n, if you write, for instance, the commutator psi A psi B, this is I h bar omega B, where this omega B means 1 minus 1 log diagonal. And it's called a symplectic structure. Okay, so let's go to something more specific. Now I introduce a state and compute correlations. Correlation functions. In a pure state, psi. So what I mean is take the state psi and look at correlations of Qs and Qs and Qs with P's, or in general psi A, psi B. Now, clearly, if you take the antisymmetric part, that's completely fixed by the canonical commutation relations. And so this I can write as h bar over 2. Yeah. The antisymmetric part is just omega AB. And then you can ask, what is the symmetric part? Well, the symmetric part, you can prove that it's positive and symmetric. So this one, anti-symmetric and fixed by commutators. And the other one, non-trivial and symmetric. It turns out it's also positive. It's not difficult to show. And actually depends on the state. Okay, now you can do this thing for any state, but if the state is Gaussian, there's something more that you can add. So for Gaussian states, GAB, if you want to call it a metric, after all, it's symmetric and positive. GB determines psi completely. No surprise, I'm really just stating the Vick's theorem. Okay, now there's a third structure that I haven't mentioned yet. That is, you have this symmetric part, the anti-symmetric part, and the third one, that is a complex structure that we can compute out of the first two. And if the state is pure and Gaussian, satisfies G squared minus the identity. Okay, so this is the kind of language and techniques that I'm gonna use. Well, it takes a bit of investment in the mathematics, but it's not different at all from, you know, learning differential geometry because you want to do general relativity. For doing this kind of calculations, you need not differential geometry. In metrics, you need symplectic geometry. And for these very simple systems, it's really linear symplectic geometry. Yeah, and you find it in this paper review with Lucas Sack that described in detail. So what do I do with that? Well, you can really compute anything for your state out of those quantities. And now I'm gonna show you how to compute the entanglement entropy out of that. And really in this logic of entanglement entropy from looking at correlations. So correlations in a subsystem. And entanglement entropy. Okay. Let me declare first what is the subsystem. The subsystem with NA bosonic degrees of freedom out of N. I can define my xia, I can split it into xia, let's say xia alpha, xi b, beta, with alpha 1 in A. And if you want this one, say alpha, you can think of it as Q1, P1, up to QNA, PNA. Okay. Now, if you have your state and you want to look at correlations in your state that you can measure by looking only at the subsystem, then these are just the same as before, but restricted. Correlations in A, these are just the same as before. So psi A alpha, alpha prime, let's say. and the restriction of the matrix that I had before. And now I can also write the restricted complex structure. Which, as I said before, is given by, did I put the minus? Yes, minus g omega minus one. Where this one, where this omega is again minus one plus one float diagonal. Now, the eigenvalues of IJA, you can show that they are real and come in pairs. After all, it's anti-Hermitian. With nu I positive, and the entanglement entropy can be computed directly from these correlation functions. So we want to compute the entanglement entropy of psi restricted to A, just compute correlations within A without ever going out of A. You take the correlations, out of the correlations, you define this matrix, compute the eigenvalues of that matrix, and you compute the sum over the eigenvalues of this function. Let me give a name to this object. Let's call it SONU. SONU I. Okay. Or if you want more formally, the statement is that SA of a pure state that is Gaussian, so I can just label it with J, is a trace of identity minus IJ restricted to A log identity minus IJA restricted to A. Okay, so lots of formal definitions. I hope you appreciate that we have turned a problem that was taking traces of Hilbert spaces into a problem where we are taking traces of a finite dimensional matrices. So I turned an exponential problem into a problem that is linear in the number of degrees of freedom. So now I want to close this part. We're going back to the oscillator, the two oscillators, and working out the exercise for two oscillators. I see that there are questions that are jumping up. Is there anything that I should address?
Yes, so there are a couple of questions relevant to what you were saying now. One from Divac. Mm-hmm. Will this method be any more efficient than just calculating the eigenvalues of row A?
It's okay if you've managed to compute that. Okay. Now, for this super simple problem that I was giving, you can compute the eigenvalues. It doesn't tell you immediately something that here becomes clear, that is, I've been saying and stating this point of view that the entanglement entropy in A is really about uncertainty of outcomes of measurements made in A. And so I want to make clear, even in the way I compute it, that I use only information that comes from measurements in A. And so I think this method shows it. But it turns out that it's also actually efficient, and for large systems, here you would have to diagonalize an operator in a Hilbert space, while here you are diagonalizing a matrix. So you can tell immediately how computationally how much more efficient it is.
Okay, thank you. So there is another question, whether you're making a specific choice for the metric for the Gaussian state.
Ah, okay, so let's go back. So you see, I guess the question is about this metric, GAB.
Yes.
So the statement is, I'm not choosing it, I'm choosing the state. Given a state, you compute correlations and that determines this metric or this correlation, okay? Now, Vick's theorem tells you that you could even do it the other way around. You give me this one and that completely determines the state. So it's really about how you thinking about a state in quantum mechanics. Is it a vector in your Hilbert space, or is it something that prescribes every possible correlation function? You're thinking of it in representation in Hilbert space, or algebraically as something that prescribes every computational correlation function. And that's going, for Gaussian states, going back between this way of thinking about it and this way of thinking about it. And it's an equality.
There are two more comments. Do you want to take them now, Arjun? You have another 50 minutes.
I am.
All right. So should there be more?
Yeah, let's take one more question. It's good that there are questions. It's important.
Okay. Can you explain again why entropy can be calculated through the eigenvalues of the complex structure?
Yeah, so I stated it without proof. I can give you an intuition, but for a full derivation, you should look at this paper on color structures. The intuition is that correlation functions capture completely the state. If you're interested only in the state restricted to A, you just need the correlation functions in A. The entanglement entropy depends on these correlation functions, but not on every property of this correlation function. It depends on the correlation functions up to unitary transformations in the subsystem. So the only thing that is invariant you can expect is not the eigenvectors, but the eigenvalues, okay? Good. I go ahead with an example and then if there are more questions, I'm gonna take more questions before we go to the next topic. So let me work out this example. The example is the one that I gave as an exercise. So two oscillators in a Gaussian state. Let me write again the state. It's called the MX and Y. It's a bit less to write. E to the minus 1/4. Let's give names that are easy to track the interpretation. So x squared over sigma x squared, y squared over sigma y squared. And then this one equal to gamma x sigma y. And you can check that if you want to normalize it, you get you need a 2 pi sigma x sigma y. Square root of 1 minus gamma square root. And clearly gamma has to be between minus 1 and 1, as you can see from the normalization. So that's my state. And the question is, compute the entanglement entropy for the degree of freedom x. So I show you this technique that I just described concretely. So you can compute correlations. For instance, I don't know, you could compute psi xx psi and find x squared 1 minus gamma squared, or you could compute psi xy and you would find minus gamma x sigma y 1 minus gamma squared. That tells you that x and y are anti-correlated if gamma is positive. So the state I'm taking is a bit as the normal modes doing like this. Okay. Yeah. Let's picture it. It's a bit like this one. Okay. And you can compute all of them, but for entropy in A, entanglement entropy in A, or I should say in XPX, that's my subsystem, or my subalgebra of observables. If I make measurements only on this oscillator, they look at the entropy of outcomes of measurements, that's going to be bounded from above by the entanglement entropy, which now I compute. So for computing it, I need these three quantities. I need XX that I already did. I need PP only for X, which you can guess, sigma X squared. And then I need the mixed one. The symmetric part I already know, the anti-symmetric part I already know because of the commutation relations. So I just take the symmetric part. And yeah, if everything is real, this is zero. Okay, so out of this, I can write this matrix GA alpha alpha prime. One half of that is sigma x squared, one minus gamma squared, zero, zero, one over four sigma x squared. Out of that, I can compute GA alpha alpha prime, which is zero, two sigma x squared over one minus gamma squared, minus one, two sigma x squared, zero. Again, values. Oh, it's a 2x2 matrix, it's easy. Plus or minus nu, with nu equal square root of one minus gamma squared. And now you plug that into the entanglement entropy. SA, or my state psi, which is just this S of nu that I wrote before. And if you plug it in, you find a plot as a function of gamma. It goes between minus one and plus one. What I say, it is, it's zero in zero, because after all, this one is one in zero, and diverges on this side and on this side. So let's go back to the state above. It's clear that if gamma is zero, this is factorized, and so entanglement entropy is zero. But if you send gamma to one, I'm telling you this state has an entanglement entropy that goes to infinity. How is that possible it goes to infinity? Well, the Hilbert space is infinite dimensional. But there's no upper bound on the entropy. Okay. Good. So that concludes this example. And I can move to part three after some question. Is there a question?
We have a couple of questions. Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, there is one by Pierre. Given a complex structure on a phase space, what is the Gaussian state associated to it? How do you write it?
Yeah, so you take the complex structure and you use it to write an annihilation operator. The formula is quite easy. Let's add it down here. One minus I J E B psi B psi, or if you want J, equals zero. So you can think of this as the annihilation operator. People sometimes really say when you do annihilation operator that is Q plus I P, You need an I to make sense of that. This J is giving you a sense of an I that is a phase space covariant. Because when you say Q plus IP, you have to identify axis Q and P in phase space. But different Gaussian states correspond to different choices of axis or basis in phase space. And so this is a basis independent way of thinking about it.
Okay, and then there is a question by Melissa, which is the last one. Let me read it out loud. In our course of quantum field theory in CST, which I don't know what that is.
Quantum field space-time. Yes.
Quantum field theory of space-time. The complex structure J split our space in positive and negative spaces associated to the eigenvalues, and then we restricted to the positive eigen space, since, as far as I remember, that was necessary to define a positive inner product on our Hilbert space. Do we have to do this restriction here as well?
Good question. So I'm presenting everything without extending my phase space to a complex phase space, but the construction is equivalent in the sense that, as you can see, it's here that this object is projecting away some parts. You see, I can project 1 minus ij or 1 plus ij. So it's here that one is doing the splitting, okay? So I'm doing it so that at the classical level, I really don't have anything complex. It's only at the quantum level when I define states that I'm introducing this sign. But the two constructions are equivalent. So I'd recommend that you look at, there's one point in this article where this map between the complexification and the real version is discussed that might help. Okay. Time. I have 30, 35 minutes left. Is that right?
Yes. Well, we could do 40 because we started 5 minutes late.
I think it should be enough. So now I've introduced enough tools that I can tell you about the area law, but not in a pictorial way, in a more concrete way where we actually compute something explicitly and we show it, okay? The reason why I've been prepared things to explain it in this way is that when Ida makes a statement about a field theory where you have to introduce a cutoff and then the area law depends on the specific cutoff, the coefficients of the area law depends on the specific cutoff, or you take a specific lattice discretization that continuum theory, but then you need methods for doing that computation. So the version that that I'm gonna present is a version that is adapted not to like a cubic lattice, but to a general lattice. I hope you're gonna find it helpful. It's the way I like to think about it when thinking about the entanglement entropy in loop quantum gravity. You need this part plus a second part that won't be able to cover, but this one I can cover. And it's something that together with Bekir Baitas and also with Pietro, we've been looking at in various systems. Okay, so area law. Area law on a bosonic lattice. This is what I'm going to explain. Let me declare what is the system. I'm going to take a graph, generic graph, gamma. I don't have to explain algebraically what it means. It means nodes connected by links. No. Put down set of nodes, then I connected my links. Some yes, some no. Let's try this. Okay. So let's give some names. Nodes. I'm gonna call them N. I'm gonna assume that they are finite number. If you want to do infinite many, you have to be careful with all these questions about Fock spaces and unitary linear equivalent Fock spaces. By keeping it finite, make it concrete, and then one can ask those questions. And more importantly, you can see the relevance of those questions, not as yes, no statements, but what physically goes wrong when you take the limit n to infinity in a unitary linear equivalent representations. Okay, so n is finite, then links, I could call them L, but I'm really gonna think of it in terms of an adjacency matrix. Matrix TNM, which is one if N and M are connected by a link, and zero otherwise. And if you want this TNM, is the definition of the graph. No, if you're given this matrix, you know the graph. From TNM, for instance, I can compute the valence of a node. Let me call it Vn. This is just, you take TNM, you look at how many links there are at that node. And you can also define a quantity. And this one is extremely important. It's called the graph Laplacian. Delta n m TNM, adjacency matrix, minus valence delta n m. Really has the properties of the Laplacian on a lattice. If you do it, for instance, on a cubic lattice, it's a discretization of the continuous Laplacian, one of the possible discretizations, like one first neighbor discretization. Yeah, but note minus delta nm as a matrix is positive semi-definite. And so its eigenvalues and eigenvectors really help you really characterize the lattice in a way it's analogous of like doing the Fourier transform for Laplace. Okay, and you see it's, if you want, it defines the lattice because TNM is the quantity that I define, that I use to define the lattice or the graph. Now, let me introduce bosonic degrees of freedom on the graph, on the nodes of the graph. So I'm gonna call them pi n and pi n, and assume that they have bosonic commutation relations. So pi n pi m I h bar delta n m. And I'm introduced also an Hamiltonian. Hamiltonian you can think of as the discretization on this graph of the continuous Hamiltonian of a massive scalar field. So it's sum n m 1/2 kinetic term plus potential term where the potential term, you can write it as a contact term and the first neighbor term. So the contact term, I'm putting coefficient one, so it's like saying mass one. I'm doing everything dimensionless. Now, how do I interpret this C squared that I'm putting it here? You can really think of it as the speed of sound, C speed of sound. In the sense that classically, if you were to make a perturbation and you look at how the perturbation travels, you would solve the equations of motion. that come from here, you get a sort of the Lambertian on the lattice with this speed C, okay? You're gonna see, I'm gonna play with this speed in a moment. Yeah, it's clear that if I set C to zero, even if you have this lattice with links, the Hamiltonian doesn't know about the links. It's just ultra local, so whatever happens at a node cannot travel zero spills. Okay. Okay, so we're interested in computing the entanglement entropy for a region. I hope you appreciate the fact that one is going from saying what is the subsystem by saying what is the sub-Hilbert space of the set of observables, so to do something that is more geometric, that is, you say what is the subsystem in terms of, tell me the region, and then I look at all the observables in that region. So let's draw the region here. So I can add a few points. Let's say that I take this as my region. Okay. Good. Subregion. Okay, so how do I compute the entanglement entropy in this subregion that I can call A? So the statement that I made before is that all I need, well, entanglement entropy, I have to say what state. So let me take a state. Vacuum of H, the vacuum exists because this is bounded from below, because this is positive semi-definite. And now I can compute the vacuum correlations. I can compute all of them at once, it's quite easy. So the phi m correlations in the vacuum. I'm calling the vacuum zero. This is just, you can prove it, it's not difficult. V to the minus one square root components nm. V is this matrix. So you really have to do the inverse and the square root as a matrix. It's not surprising, you know, if it was one single harmonic oscillator, yeah, there would be a omega squared. And yeah, I would say one over two omega. This is the generalization to many. You can also do pi m zero. This is 1/2 square root of V and M. And for this system, you can also compute the symmetrized correlation. I am. Turns out to be zero. Okay. Now, if I want the entanglement entropy in the region, all I need is measuring the correlation function between this and this, this and this, this and this, for both Q and P, so phi and pi. So let me write it here. Correlations in A. I don't have to do anything. I just have to restrict N and then to A. Or if you want, as a matrix, you introduce a projector. PA and M. They just say it's zero if n and m are outside, or n or m outside, and one if it's inside. Okay. Once you have the correlations, it's immediate to compute the complex structure. And I'm going to need the complex structure restricted to A. So complex structure restricted A. So I just have to multiply by the matrix plus one minus one of diagonal, and you get zero. Yeah, goes the square root of V minus one. Yeah, the square root of V. But I have to put it in the subsystem. So I'm going to put a projector. Okay. And out of this one, I should be able to compute the entanglement entropy. Now, you can do that computation, but I want to show you something simple. That is, we know that at zero speed of sound, there's no, that this state is going, the ground state is going to have no correlations. So let's do an expansion at small speed of sound to see what we get. Expansion. Small speed of sound. It is C much smaller than one. C is dimensionless, everything is dimensionless. Yeah, so let's recall that V was written as one minus C squared graph Laplacian as matrices. What I'm gonna need is things like a projector V minus one square root projector. Now I can certainly expand this square root. No, I just say this is identity plus C squared. Yeah, the linear, am I doing it right? Yes, there's a square root, one half C squared Laplacian, and then I have to go to next order. If you do it, you get the C4 Laplacian, Laplacian plus dot, dot, dot projector, okay? Now, if I bring in the projector, this is identity in A plus one half C squared Laplacian in A plus three over eight C4. And here is where I have to be careful. Now there's a projector here, Laplacian, but then in between the Laplacians, there's no projector. But I can still write projector in A plus projector in B, because that's the identity. Laplacian, projector in A plus dot, dot, dot. One more step, identity in A. This I copy. Yeah, I also copy a piece that is Laplacian A, Laplacian A plus dot dot dot, plus a piece that is actually non-trivial, that is 3 8 C to the four projector in A, Laplacian projector in B, Laplacian projector in A. Now this piece, as you can see, connects A with B, but the only place where you can connect A with B is the boundary. So you can call it tau AB. It is the adjacency matrix. Restricted to the boundary of the region A. That is, it's non-zero only for these specific links, the ones across the boundary. Maybe I need this one. So how do I highlight it? Let's see. Let's see this. So that means this link. Okay. Okay, so now you're gonna see why that formula that I gave you before, it's so helpful. Now that I've done this job, now I can compute the entanglement. I should say the entanglement for both state, the vacuum of the Hamiltonian. So often people call it vacuum entanglement. In region A. You see, I'm not saying the observables, I'm saying the region. So often people call it geometric vacuum entanglement. So this is SA of the state zero, which you could try to compute as trace of A of rho A log rho A, but that would be hard work. What I'm telling you is that you can use this formula that I gave you before, that is trace on phase space. So on inverse space. This is on phase space. Of what? So I wrote identity name minus ija log modulus identity name minus ija log 2. It's clear that at small speed of sound, I can expand everything in here as a function of C. You do the series, you get a log C trace of that adjacent symmetric tau AB plus order C to the 4. The data adjacent symmetrics, if you take the trace, it just counts how many links you have in the boundary. Which, if you want, you can think of it as the area of the border of A, which is really the number of links crossing the boundary. And this is the lowest order, but if you were to go at higher orders in C, you would get other pieces that don't go as the area law, but some other pieces still go with the area law that correct this coefficient. Okay, so I should pause for questions. And then if there's time remaining, I tell you briefly about subalgebras. Then I would like to take questions first.
Eugenio, there is one question in the chat by Dripto, by a subregion in the I think the question is whether there is some sort of strict definition that the subregion must be a subgraph in some sense.
I see the question. I somehow didn't hear part of the way you were phrasing it, but let me answer specifically. So yeah, subregion, I mean a subgraph, and I'm adding subgraph that is connected, so that you can reach, you can join any two nodes with a series of links. All the definitions that I gave apply to any subalgebra of observables. So if you just do the restriction, if you use this formula with PA or the restriction to A that tells you what subalgebra of observables you are using, that formula still works. But yeah, I worked it out only for this specific notion, that is the one that one uses generally to mean a geometric entanglement. So the answer is yes, subregion in sense of connected subgraph.
There is a follow-up question. I still don't get it. The physical definition of C as a spin on sound. Can you elaborate on that?
Yeah, so let's go back to the Hamiltonian. Something the Hamiltonian has a pi square term, a phi square term that are ultra local, that is some side by side, and then a first neighbor coupling. I'm not saying interaction, people often refer the word interaction for something that is higher than power two, higher than quadratic, calling it coupling. There's a coupling between nearby sites. Nearby is written in here, it's this adjacency matrix. And I need a coupling constant for that. So people are doing many body systems, many body spin systems, I would call this hopping coupling. From the point of view of taking a continuous Lagrangian out of which you get a continuous Hamiltonian and then you put it on a lattice and you discretize it on the lattice. In the continuum, you get that the continuum Lagrangian has the Lambertian that is dt square minus c square spatial Laplacian. So that c square would be the speed of light. If you were to instead, and so it confirms this notion that I'm giving you as speed of sound. If you were instead of to take a crystal, in a crystal you have nearby atoms in the crystal that couple harmonically. So this would be just a coupling constant. But then if you look at the speed of perturbation for phonons in that crystal, they propagate at a speed that is C. And so now I'm adding to that the vacuum of this system has properties that depend on the speed of sound. And in particular, you can read the dependence on the speed of sound in the entanglement entropy. Are there more questions?
I do not see any in the chat, but if anyone has one, you can also unmute and ask at this point. There is one in the chat. If we compute the entanglement entropy for another state that is not the vacuum state of the graph, do we still have a relationship with the boundary area or how does it change?
Oh, excellent question. Thank you, Monica, for asking this question. So, so the short answer is it's a property of the vacuum of an Hamiltonian with a local coupling. Let me convince you in reverse. Like suppose that I take a high energy state of the same Hamiltonian. Then for a high energy state, if I trace out everything outside of this region, the entropy in this region would scale as the volume of the region, which would cover the area. Okay. In fact, if this was not a bosonic system, but a fermionic system, I could even use a Page argument to say a random state in my Hilbert space as the entropy is close to the maximal entropy that is the log of the dimension of the Hilbert space, that is the sum of the logs of the dimensions, and so would scale like the volume. So the short answer is it's a property of the vacuum of Hamiltonians with local coupling.
Okay, there is one more question by Pierre, whether you could write down the equivalent continuous Lagrangian of your discrete model.
Yeah, so
it
would be S of I equal integral d mu phi with my signature, there's a minus, there's a 1/2, and here there's a minus 1/2 m squared phi squared. Okay, and then you go to Hamiltonian theory first, and then you discretize because your time is continuous for this. Okay, Which is different from what people in lattice field theory do when they discretize space-time. Yeah, this was a graph evolving in continuous time. So I'm discretizing only space. Which brings up another question of, can you do that and preserve Lorentz invariance? I think it's an interesting question, and hopefully I'm gonna have a paper out soon about that. Okay, so time, there is 10 minutes, right?
Yes, I mean 15.
Good. So let me go to part four. That is really a remark with an example on something abstract, but that I find extremely useful as a way of thinking about entanglement entropy. So let me write it as quantum fields, because that's what I'm going to use as example. And subalgebra observables. Subalgebras of observables. And I just want to be concrete, really concrete, and give you first an example. Just to show you how everything we did up to this point applies to a quantum field. So let me be concrete. Let me consider a massless scalar field. Phi of x and t in Minkowski. And I take the Minkowski vacuum as a state. Continuum, there's no discretization, no UV cutoff. Note this state. So this massless, I mean free massless, no interaction. So the vacuum is Gaussian. And now let me do the thing that I've been advocating this. Think about observables. And to be extreme, I'm gonna say I have only one detector that can only check if my field is excited in a region where the detector is with a certain resolution. So let's introduce a smearing on the field, like take a region and you take a smearing with compact support in this region. And let's say R. And define my smearing of the field as phi f. So this is my f of x. As just so what smearing means, inter and d3x, f of x, operator phi of x and t. We just want to be sure to see which ones are operators, I just put that up so that it's clear. And I want a full algebra of observables. So what I need is phi f of t and phi dot f of t and everything that I can build out of them. And note then the commutator of phi f times t equals time phi f dot of t. This you can compute inter n d3x, inter n d3y, f. Then you get phi of x, phi dot of y. So this just gives you I inter n d3x phi of x squared. And if you choose this one to be a probability distribution, this is just one. So this is just I. If it was not, the methods work anyway. But that gives you an algebra of observables. So now if you want to compute the entanglement entropy, that is the entropy of the bound on the entropy of measurements on this subsystem as probed by this detector, what do you do? Voila, you just compute vacuum correlations in this subalgebra. So 1/2 G A B is a function of T. It's just this one. Phi F. Phi dot F. Then I need also the mixed ones. They call that they don't commute. This is only the symmetrized part. Symmetrized, we have 1/2. Same here. And out of that, you can get the eigenvalues of JA. Not surprisingly, JF. Not surprisingly, these are new that you can write as square root of what? Well, this is a 2x2 matrix. It's easy to find eigenvalues. But I think that if I write it, you also recognize what I'm writing. I'm writing the Heisenberg uncertainty relations. I'm writing the Heisenberg uncertainty relations in the sense of this being the product delta Q delta P. Delta Q delta P, the Robertson form where I subtract minus this other piece squared. Okay, I made it squared. And so out of that, you can get the entropy S of the subalgebra that you want, if you want, it's the subalgebra F, which is just that function S of nu that I gave you before, the log function. Okay. Now you can compute it explicitly. You can do it for the Minkowski vacuum. In fact, you can do it for any vacuum in your quantum field theory for space time. All of these things just require that you know how to compute these correlation functions, which are actually quite easy to compute. Okay. Okay, so how is this related to the area law? This is like really, I have a detector. If you have two detectors localized, one here, one there, you could do the mutual information. You could do everything that we have said up to now for finite dimensional system, for infinite dimensional system by looking at finite subalgebras. So now you can ask the following question. Take the subalgebra of n observables in a region, geometric region A, we support. Just to give you an example, you could say phi nlm of t, that is the integral of your region in D3X, some radial function, spherical harmonics, and then phi and x and t. And it's up to n. It is up to a finite UV resolution epsilon. So these ones are all functions of compact support in here, but modulated, you know, to draw them. But in Rutan spherical harmonics, I can compose them so that they would have like something like this, to probe more and more details of the region. So you can compute the entanglement entropy now. And you can check this in this paper that I was citing with Alejandro Satz of 2019. We introduced explicitly a set of functions of this kind. And as long as this set of functions is finite, the entropy is finite, now you can look at what happens in the limit when you refine it. So limit epsilon to zero, and you find area of the boundary of the region over epsilon squared. Why I think this is nice? I think this is nice because it gives you an interpretation of what is this area law concretely, not in the sense of you take your theory, you modify it by introducing a UV cutoff, so it becomes another theory. For instance, you put it on a lattice, so you find a way of killing high energy degrees of freedom. What I'm saying is take your ordinary quantum field theory, for instance, in Minkowski space, but then probe it only with observables that are supporting the region and a finite resolution in this region. So they don't probe the ultraviolet, or they probe the ultraviolet up to a smaller scale epsilon. And so they can see the correlations across the boundary up to some scale, a finite resolution. And as you increase that resolution, you see this area law with this divergence arising. Okay? And if you were to say, what's the entanglement entropy of all of the possible observables in the region with arbitrarily high resolution, the answer is just infinite, with no surprise. The Hilbert space is infinite dimensional. And so it's not like saying this state is maximally entangled. There's no maximum for the entanglement. OK, so I think that's a good point for me where to stop. I'm happy to take more questions if there's time. Otherwise, we go to the last point that is these arguments about quantum fields and subalgebras.
Yeah, I can take a question. Questions don't seem in the app.
Yes, I'm happy to take questions. If anybody has questions, raise your hands or write on Menti or anything that works. So I see a question, I can read it. For the relative entropy, will the relative entropy change if we change the density matrices we are interested in, like S rho A times rho B with respect to rho AB? Oh, you exchange them, I see. Yes, it changes. Okay, it's not symmetric. No, it's not a distance of You see, I'm always careful in saying rho with respect to sigma, okay? Yeah. This quantity takes lots of different names in different fields, Kullback divergence or like in a, if you have a special state that you have as a good hypothesis, like checking if the state has the properties of a thermal state, here's where you put your hypothesis, and you test your hypothesis by looking at the relative entropy of the quantity that you want to check how close it is to your product, okay? In machine learning, you use essentially the classical version, the classical information theoretic version of this one.
Any more questions? No? We could wrap it up, Eugenio. We're exactly 2 hours.
Very good. Was fun. Thanks for all the questions. I hope you find some of these things useful. It was fun to
can you tell us what is the next